again.
If you are a politician, get ready to hide under the desk. The real Tony D. Tony D. Angelo Tuesday, 7 a.m. Eastern on the Lee Elci Show at 94.9 News and Stimulating Talk.
The Seat of Honor. Brought to you by Densmore Oil and Bugby Plumbing.
Are you there?
He's up late to give you the news you can't get anywhere else early. He fights for truth and justice in the American way. Please welcome our pal from the Paragon Trust Company, the real Tony D, Tony D'Angelo.
All right, here we go, ladies and gentlemen. So actually, 8 minutes now after the hour of 7 o'clock. I know you're all waiting with the bated breath and anticipation. He has his own YouTube page, which is something you should frequent. Of course, and also he's on the Twitter or the X at Tony D'Angelo 7, and that's our good friend Tony D. Tony, good morning. How are you, sir?
Good morning, Lee Elci. Good morning, everybody, and proud to be among you.
Got my power bill the other day, and they whacked me across the knees. Eversource Public Benefits, executive order. What's new, Tony?
Well, you know something? So much of this, and this is the way it usually goes with me as far as just the period I've been running into, September and October of 2024, which, you know, personally for me is one for the record books. But I'm getting increasingly impatient about being lied to and being dictated to as to what I should believe and what's right and what's wrong and what's credible and what isn't. We left off last week, and I made the statement and I made the tweet, and I said, well, you know, you can, it's not even, if you think about it, it's not even a stretch in the least that this public benefits charge, the burden it puts on every single Connecticut resident, to the point where, you know, they're not, people aren't going to pay their bills, the, you know, so many things, so much sewage and so much apartment heat is, or even house heat is driven by electricity. They're going to turn the bills, you know, they're going to turn the thermostats down and. And, you know, we're headed headlong into, I mean, a genuine public health crisis. And, you know, I don't want to get graphic, but, you know, and so I ask myself, you know, poor little pea brain that I am, well, whenever there seems to be any sort of a magnified public health crisis in Connecticut, our governor, King Governor Ned Lamont the Unaccountable, and before him, Dan Malloy, you know, would write an executive order kind of fixing the thing. So I made the statement. I said, look, I wrote out on Twitter the same damn executive order that he used for COVID. Instead, I used power. And I said, okay, here's the executive order. I challenged anybody in the world, you disagree with me that this is something that the unaccountable cannot do to, like, quote-unquote, have a cooling-off period, you know, so we'd be okay until we got back into session or something like that? I said, I double-dog dare you. Come fight with me. Call me an idiot. Embarrass me. Lee Elci, not one person came. And I'm saying to myself, we've been sitting there saying this whole thing of, oh, we need a special session. We need a special session. The unaccountable can do this with a flick of his pen. It is a grave situation that's going to happen. And I get so tired of people saying, well, yeah, this is the way it is and there's nothing we can do. I mean, that ought to be the state. That ought to be the motto on our state flag. Connecticut, there's nothing we can do. So I just wanted to let everybody know that, and I also want to let them know that maybe it's time you started going to the governor's office and saying, hey, man, sign the damn order. You know, I mean, it's like, what are we going to be headed into? Are we going to be headed into sub-zero temperatures? Are we going to be headed into to cutoffs? And I mean, you know, and again, you've got a conflicted organization here. You have had people in the legislature who have worked for Eversource. I think you maybe got one or two now. I mean, this mess doesn't end until there's accountability, until, like, you know, just get all the crap out of the way, get to the facts, and let's see what's happening. So that's my first thing. I'm just very angry about
that. So I think we were one of the first people to scream that this public benefit was coming. So I think the station, some of the politicians, we talked about it, sort of went on deaf ears. What's coming on the horizon, Tony, and something we need to pay attention to, I'll just announce it again right now, is, you know, if they decide to sign off and they all intentions they're going to on this wind gig, and you're going to incorporate that into your electric bill, Greg Howard said this yesterday. We've been talking about this forever. Your electric bill is going to triple. So if you're paying $300, you're going to pay close to $1,000 a month for electric bill once they do this. It's looming on the horizon. This is going to happen.
And you know, this is where you know, put it this way: if I had Elvis Presley money, I'd buy a Derringer and I'd be shooting out radios and TVs and things. When people come on and say, "Oh, the governor's a reasonable guy. Oh, the governor's a moderate thing," you know, it's like he quote unquote has a good head. The reason why he's not jumping in here the way he did in COVID-19 is because he had money on the table in COVID-19, just the way it is, okay? And the other thing is that he is beholden to the greenies and the wind people and the this and the that. He doesn't want to, quote unquote, make them think that he's not the coolest guy on the planet. So it's like, you know, at this point, you know, with the country kind of teetering on the brink of, you know, whatever it is you want to call it, extinction, Armageddon and stuff. I mean, I'm going to bare metal. It's just the way it is.
But I'll tell you, that's a game changer. This is a game changer, what we're going through now. But if your electric bills triple, I don't know how people can afford anything anymore. It'd be over.
Well, that's just it. And I mean, he can suspend economics with a stroke of his pen. He did it before. You know, and if you disagree with me, go to executive order ct.gov. Just look at all the executive orders, Lamont, Malloy. Some of these things are so ridiculous. I mean, they're laughable if they were funny. And it's always like you get this thing of there's nothing we can do. Of course, there's something you can do. The health and the safety of the residents of Connecticut are at stake, and nobody gives a damn.
Right, 100%. You're right on the money. All right, so that's one, public benefits, executive order.
Let's put it this way. We're on the truth tour this morning, right? We're on the straighten up and fly right tour.
All right.
There's an article. Actually, this was Connecticut News Junkie. It's circulating. This is back a couple of weeks, and I had completely forgotten about it, but I think apropos of what we're discussing here. We've talked about it before. There is a venture capital arm of the state of Connecticut, and you know, in investment parlance, it's known as, you know, crapshoot the market. Maybe something will happen, and this is state tax money with investors invested in startup corporations, which many are concepts. None of really, very few get to where they have an established market value, and it is an experimental venture, and the auditors of public accounts, and I've always said that the auditors of public accounts have done some great work. We're going to find out here they kind of dropped the ball, you know, somewhat. And but the official article, the official press release that they gave to the official press that went to you know, the unofficial us, said, well, you know, there's issues in this audit report as far as what this venture capital arm Connecticut Innovations is doing. Report's 18 pages, and whatever you want to call it, the banner ad was they claim that they created 31,950 jobs in fiscal year 2021. And 27,836 jobs in the following year. And this is right from the article in the Connecticut News Junkie. However, it was impossible to verify these numbers. So in other words, Lee Elci, I can tell you whatever in the hell I want to. It's just that, but I don't have to verify it. And they got slapped on the hand and they didn't dispute it, but yet the funding will continue. I mean, if this were me doing something like this, they would kill me. They would drag me in I-395 and run tractor trailers over my head. This, I mean, go ahead and make up whatever you want. The also some other stuff, you know, they didn't file reports on time and. But there's something here which really the news media didn't pick up, the auditors didn't pick up, the Republican Party didn't pick up. And, you know, I read this report, I read this audit, And there's a statement of revenues, expenses, and changes in net position over 3 years. The operating income is, they say, is $22 million, but a large part of the operating income is how are they making so much money? Well, they base a lot of it on something called unrealized appreciation. What's unrealized appreciation? If I have an IRA account and I have a little bit of stock in it, and let's just say I bought $1,000 worth of stock, and I look one day and the stock is worth $3,000, I did not sell the stock. That's $2,000 of unrealized appreciation. You know, so if I wanted to go in and sell that stock today, I could do so on an exchange and somebody would give me, you know, some fluctuation of that $3,000. Here in Connecticut Innovations, we deal in things with no market value. You know, there's no, you know, come and invest in my concept. Come and invest in my wonderful idea and look at the unrealized appreciation that it's worth. Well, who determines that, Lee Elci? I mean, it's like, can you, like, walk into an exchange and say, well, this is worth, you know, 40-something million dollars more? Of course you can. You know, so these are like make-believe values. Total and complete make-believe values. Now, it doesn't mean that they're worth less, but they're very, very, very subjective. And how this is done and what the requirements are and who does it, are these qualified appraisals? Are they not qualified appraisals? Are there really buyers that would give you that much? We have no idea, but it's your tax money. It's your tax money. Another thing, and this, believe me, talk about, you know, having Elvis Presley's derringer. There's, in 2020, there's $10 million paid for something called proof of concept funding. What the hell is that? Proof of concept funding. So I've got this great idea. I've got this great concept. I don't know what it is. I don't know what it's going to do. But, you know, wouldn't it be nice to have $10 million to prove if it can do something or not? It's your tax money. And you know something? The news media didn't pick that up. The auditors didn't pick that up. And Republican Party didn't pick that up. I mean, these are the things that drive you stark, staring crazy. And you know, and the other thing is that, again, let's talk about history, because we can't talk about history in Connecticut. Connecticut Innovations was a funder to Semaphore, and they did have a big kill, actually, between 2021 and 2022, and quote-unquote realized gain. Now, a lot of that, of course, has got to be Semaphore, because, you know, probably they did it and they haven't had one since. So it's like, what I'm looking at this, and this is the thing. If I'm going to say, if I'm going to start making fiction in the work I do, they will throw me in jail. If you make fiction in Connecticut, politicians will sit there and applaud and say, well, we need to have better regulation. I mean, this is really, this is insane. It really is insane. It's like, can somebody call for the abolishment of that? Or if this is something that's really good, you're going to have a lot more controls on it. There is a statement from the Republican Party saying Republicans will continue to emphasize the importance of evaluating government incentive programs and must encourage and retain these programs that are working while quickly eliminating those that are not successful. So it's like, you know, hey guys, it's like, if you can't read a report, ask for help. I mean, basically, come to me. I would certainly do this for you. I mean, this is just absolutely, and put it this way, what you're getting from me right now is just the compound effect of being lied to and lied to and lied to. And, I mean, I don't know about anybody else, man, but I've had enough.
Tony D'Angelo, Tony D'Angelo 7 on Twitter. Check out his YouTube feed as well. You mentioned to the, what do they call it? Unintended gains?
Unrealized appreciation.
Yeah. Okay, so am I wrong that that was... Suppose that's not for everybody, though, right? I mean, I thought it was for people who, it was only for people who were worth $100 million or more. I don't know.
Put it this way: you might, you know,
I'm not saying that's right, but I just want to make sure.
You might have unrealized appreciation in like your baseball cards.
Yep.
You know, And, you know, it's like my baseball card, my 52 Mickey Mantle is now worth $50,000. Now, the day that you go over to the Putnam Antiques, if you could find somebody with that much money to buy it from you, they're not going to give you $50,000. They'll give you something less. They'll give you something. Right. That's realized appreciation. That's actual dollars falling. The only way you can figure out unrealized appreciation is if there is an established market for an asset. There is no established market for, excuse me, crapshoot stock. None. None. Right. You know, it's like if you think a deal is good, you get in with a bunch of people, you kind of throw some money, and I did this once, lost my shirt, but, you know, and then one day you wake up and you think you'll be a millionaire, you're only thousands of dollars poorer. Now, right. That does not mean that some of these things aren't good, aren't viable, and right. That risk is a bad thing, right. But it's like you're writing up this whole concept on unrealized appreciation and proof of concept funding. In other words, to use my seventh grade educated father's terms, thin air, guess, you know, hypotheses.
Right. All right. Spinning from that, so talk to me, wrap it up here and tell me why Republicans are losing.
This is why they're losing. They can't deal in they can't attack concepts. And this is the thing. I want to see Republicans win more than anybody. This is why I'm hard on them. You know, and this is because we know really where they need to do better on all levels. I'm watching this thing. There's a very good editorial, actually an opinion piece that Bob Swick sent me last night from the Wall Street Journal about why do the young vote left. Is the young are given this candy view of the world that, you know, to your point earlier, the president's cool or the vice president's cool. She can go on a podcast and, you know, we don't need the constructs we have in society. And we can do a lot with AI and the government can support us because they've been fed this thing forever and ever and ever. But I'm watching an excerpt of the Kamala Harris interview on 60 Minutes. And she's talking about taxes. Now her talking about taxes is like me talking about, you know, high-grade chemistry. I have no idea what I'm talking about. And politicians always come out, and it frustrates me on both sides. And she says, well, you know, the lower-income people pay more than the higher-income people. And what they do is that it's remember algebra. You've got to subtract something from both sides. So that if you're a working person, you pay Social Security to a certain amount. And if you are a high-grade working person, you will pay Social Security to a certain amount, and that's capped. Now, if after a while you start paying taxes at a rate that's effectively, if you're higher, if you're more highly compensated, that looks higher than what the lower-income person is paying, but it's a distorted how could I put it? It's a distorted comparison. You've got to subtract out Social Security from both sides. When you do that, you look at quote unquote real taxes. And when you actually get to that, the higher tip people, especially in places like New York, Connecticut, California, are doing like 46%, 45%. The game changes. So it's like it just frustrates the hell out of me when they, you know, Democrats make these statements and Republicans never attack the concept. They just attack it saying, well, you know, you don't know what you're talking about. We'll prove it. So, I mean, it's that's one thing. The other thing is, how do you actually get to these like bird brain people that think that the government is going to make them whole forever? And I think you can marry those two concepts economically if you boil it down to what it really is. But at this point, it's like, you know, there's one series of lies and the other side is just not doing a very good job of explaining it. And it doesn't take a lot of thought to explain it, but it's just to make the concepts more clear. And I guess my moral to the story today is don't believe everything you read. You know, the biblical always said, try the spirits. Find out if what's happening is really true. You have to do a little digging. You have to do a little incisive work. And when you do, you'll find out that many times what's actually true as opposed to what they're telling you are often two different things.
Real quick, because I wanted to ask you this anyway. Do you think the Social Security should be capped? the taxes should be capped on people making, I think it's $77,000 or something like that.
Have a forever, an annual earnings cap?
Well, no. In other words, I think once you reach a certain amount of income, you don't pay tax on anything over that. I never understood that. Why is that the case?
I think you go back to the Social Security Act of 1937, and it was never intended to, quote-unquote, be a, if people kept doing that, if the highest people kept paying Social Security over and over and over again, you would have such a distortion in society and retirees, where you'd have incredibly rich retirees versus incredibly poor retirees. It was never intended to do that. Now, you could debate the benefits of that, but the idea was to give everybody some quote-unquote basic retirement income.
Yeah, but I think
my father, the few adult discussions I had with him before he passed on was, why do we need Social Security? Why don't we have private investment accounts? And he was of an age where, as a boy, he actually saw people carted off to the poorhouse because they had nothing. It was forced savings. The idea was to give you a little bit of forced savings. And whether that's good, bad, and different otherwise, I think that would be a great form.
Well, no, I'm just thinking because even if it was a regressive tax, once you got to, like, say, the $800,000, let's use $100,000. If you make over $100,000, now that's not taxed. I mean, even if you're, like, right now, I think people, Social Security, hasn't that tax rate gone up significantly for people here recently or no? Am I missing that?
Social Security now is taxed on your tax return.
No, but I'm
that
saying.
That was never supposed to be.
No, no,
that
I know.
It actually
that.
Started with Ronald Reagan in 1984, and then it started with 50%. Al Gore made it 85%. Because it was never, ever, ever supposed to be, quote unquote, taxed income.
Right.
Now, the part that's withdrawn from your pay is there's an annual cap. Once your earnings hit a certain level, you don't get to contribute more in. It's like a, how could I put it? If that was like, I think it's like 7.65%. If that went on forever and ever and ever and ever, you would have people with these, bulbous retirement accumulations. And I don't think that was the intention. It was also the intention for it never to be taxed until we got in trouble with the budget. And now we had to start taxing it.
No, but I guess what I'm saying, and we got to go. We'll pick it up next time. Is that? After a certain amount, no, that money's not taxed. So if you're making $50 million a year, you're only taxed on Social Security wise on the first $100,000. If you were taxed on all of it, the amount people would have to pay would be significantly less. And the people who are making $50 million don't need Social Security anyway. So what they get, I think everybody would be elevated in that case. Does that make any sense?
Yeah, I think you might have a distortion in retirees. You'd have the $50 million guy would be rolling in dough as time goes on, and then the other person, because he'd be drawing out at a higher rate.
Yeah, but you'd max out.
That would be the problem.
I would say you'd max out on what you could get from Social Security. Like, you wouldn't have the ability to that guy making $50 million wouldn't get, $70,000 a month from Social Security. He would only get
okay. So in
maximum.
Other words, you'd have him paying in and not taking out. Yeah. I don't know how happy he's going to be. That would certainly.
Well, no, but isn't that happening now anyway? Though, to a certain extent, there's, I don't know. Yeah, we'll have to go. Let's go over that one day. We'll figure that out.
Yeah, it's an interesting concept.
Yeah. All right, Tony. Thank you, buddy. I gotta go. All right, we'll be back, everybody. Bruce Flax joins us next.
Took a monkey for a ride in the air. The monkey thought that everything was on the square. The buzzer tried to throw